See one of the, let's say, most recent developments in the YAML code. So what you saw up to now is, let's say, the historical part of the code or how the code was started. And you saw the tool to compute the quasi-particle properties within GW or other approximations, and to describe excitons within the beta salpeta. So this was the, let's say, first part which was developed in the code. And instead, more recently, well, let me switch even this one. And instead, more recently, well, the project started now more or less 10 years ago. It was started by Andrea Marini, Claudio Taccalite, and Mirta Gruning. It was developed a part in the code which does the real-time propagation of an equation of motion. Actually, there are two strategies implemented. An equation of motion for the density matrix and an equation of motions for the block wave functions. So these two strategies can be used for different things and among others to do what I call here real-time spectroscopy. So I will briefly discuss what is the concept of real-time spectroscopy compared to, let's say, frequency space spectroscopy. So I start really from the beginning. So if we do spectroscopy in general, we think that we apply a perturbation, an electric field to a material, and then the material reacts, creating an internal polarization. And then the sum of the electric field and the polarization is what is called the electric displacement. And in general, one can write an equation which relates the change in the polarization to the applied electric field via some coefficient. And in general, this relation is non-linear, so there is a linear term, but there are also second order terms, third orders, and so on. But if the external perturbation is weak enough, one can think that all the higher order terms are negligible, and thus can focus on the linear response of the system. So this is the equation for the linear response, which can be Fourier transformed from the time to the frequency domain. So the convolution becomes just a multiplication. And this object, alpha, which is the polarizability of the system, can be used to define the dielectric function, which is what we learned in the yesterday, basically. So one just has to take the relation, this relation, and plug it in the equation which relates polarization, electric displacement and electric field, and then replace the electric displacement as the dielectric function times the field. And there is a relation between epsilon omega, the dielectric function, and alpha of omega, which is written here. So this is what one computes, what one uses to compute the dielectric function in frequency space. This alpha omega can be expressed via the Fermi-Golden rule, or can be expressed with higher order approaches like the RPA, the Bethe-Salpeter. But another strategy, instead of going through the calculation of this linear response quantity, is to directly compute the induced polarization and then divide it by the applied electric field, and then to obtain the dielectric function via this relation. So how we do that in practice? So the idea is that we really take the perturbation, so an electric field which we want to apply to our material. We evolve some equation, and then I will describe which is the equation. And then from this equation, we extract the time-dependent polarization. And then we know the applied perturbation, we know the polarization, we just Fourier transform both, and we directly get the dielectric function of the system. So I want to stress that this way of extracting the properties of from a material, it's much similar to what they do experimentally, because experimentally they really take a perturbation, they excite a material, and then they have some detector, which basically reads the polarization in this case. And how it works in practice, so there are these three steps, and you will see when we will do the simulation this afternoon that there are indeed three steps even in the implementation of this strategy. So first of all, you choose the perturbation, which is the probe of your material, which can be a delta-like perturbation or a perturbation which has a sine shape, and you want to apply it to the material. And the first thing you realize that if you apply the perturbation, then you have to you break some of the symmetries of the system. And so before running the simulations, you will see, you will start using these YPPRT or YPPNL, which has the post-processing tools of YAMBO, and actually remove the symmetries which are not consistent with such perturbation. And here you already see that there is this YPP underscore RT, YPP underscore NL. So the executable you will use, they are slightly different from the ones you used up to now, before you had just YPP. And it means that the code will be compiled with some extra capabilities which are related to the RT, real-time project, or NL, nonlinear optics project. Then once you prepare your folder with the wave functions with removed symmetries, I will speak again about that, you perform the actual real-time propagation. So there are two different executables because there are two different strategies. And now, in this lecture, I will mostly focus on this strategy, the propagation of the density matrix, while after me, Claudio will describe mostly this strategy, so the propagation of the wave function. And basically, after you have the time-dependent density matrix, so you know how it evolves in time under the action of the pulse, you construct the polarization, and then you post-process the polarization. So the third step is again to take the post-processing tool, Fourier transform the polarization, and get the absorption spectra of the system. So as you can see, it's a way to get the absorption. So in a sense, it contains the same physics of the linear response, or even beyond. And it contains the same physics of the Bethe-Salpeter if you have the proper approximations. So this is the general idea, and but YAMBO is a many-body perturbation theory code, or better, an ab initio many-body perturbation theory code. So like in the other tutorials, one has to start from a density functional theory calculation, and then use the wave functions and the energies to build up all the many-body perturbation theory quantities. This holds for all the tutorials we did up to now. The main difference for real time is that now we also have to deal with a time-dependent laser pulse. So as far as many-body perturbation theory is concerned, the main difference is that you can still write a Dyson equation, for example, for the green function. It's exactly the same Dyson equation which you saw before. But this time, this green function is defined not on the standard real-time axis, but on this finely contoured in time. So which are the consequences of that? Well, the main consequence is that then you take this green function from the contour and you want to bring it back to the real axis because you want to deal with something which you can manage. And when you do that, you end up with different components of the green function. So there is, you will see that here we have a lesser, a greater, and a retarded and an advanced green function. So the label just depends on how the operators which defines the green function are ordered on the contour and then on how you bring them back to the real axis. So I don't want to enter in the details, it's just a quick overview to understand what happens to many-body perturbation theory. And in particular, what you will have is that this Dyson equation will become basically a differential equation for the time propagation of these two quantities, the lesser and the greater green function. So this is the phase of this differential equation. So there is the time evolution of this lesser and greater green function. There is a first piece, which here is called the Hartree-Fock Hamiltonian, and the second piece, which is called the collision integral. And basically, any approximation of the self-energy, which is static, can enter in this part of the equation, and any approximation, which is dynamical, will enter in this part. So you see, this thing is the complex object of the theory, it's called the collision integral, and it contains an integral over time of the self-energy times, again, the green functions. And here, if you take a static self-energy, this integral will go to zero. So it's a very complex object, it's a two-time function, but indeed we do not need often to know the two-time quantity. It's enough to know the time diagonal of this quantity, which is indeed the density matrix of the system. So one can just take the time diagonal and write the equation of motion for the time diagonal. This equation of motion is not yet closed because here you have this collision integral which depends on the two times Green functions. But if one takes a static self-energy, then the collision integral goes to zero. So neglecting the collision integral, you have an equation of motion for the density matrix. It's a very simple equation of motion, could have been derived directly starting from the density matrix and the Hartree-Fock Hamiltonian, for example. But so in this way, you saw even an exact equation, which brings to that with some controlled approximation. And you also have some way to, if you want to extend the equation of motion and to deal even with effects which are beyond the static approximation to the self-energy. So this in detail, the Hartree-Fock Hamiltonian, there is the Bayer Hamiltonian, and which is just the Bayer electronic Hamiltonian, and then the Hartree-Fock self-energy, which is a functional of the density matrix. And of course, since we are in real time, there is the external potential. So I used Hartree-Fock up to now because it's how you find the description of the Kadanoff-Bain equations and well, the equation of motion for the density matrix in textbooks. But indeed, if you want to run simulations on a real system, it's much better to use this H-sex approximation, which is basically the same as Hartree-Fock. The only difference is that the Fock term, the exchange, is statically screened. Okay, this is the equation of motion, which I write here in the ab initio form. So it's exactly the same, the time propagation of the density matrix. And this time, I write explicitly how the density matrix is propagated in the Yambo code. So the density matrix, as you know, is a function of two space variables, r and r prime, and just one time. What we do, we project on the Kunesham wave functions, and here is where the DFT starting point enters. And thus, the density matrix becomes a matrix in the Kunesham indexes, or in the band indexes. So for each k point, there is an n by m matrix, where n and m are the number of bands you consider. So it runs both on the occupied and the empty states. Of course, you need an initial condition. So you assume that in the ground state, you have just occupied, you use the equilibrium occupation. So if you have a semiconductor, you just have the valence band. So when n is in valence, this is 1. When n is in conduction, this is 0. And the off-diagonal terms are 0. And then you propagate. So here you have again the equilibrium Hamiltonian plus the changes in the Hartree and exchange correlation part, just the static part of exchange correlation and the pulse. So with respect to before, I have just written here the variations of the exchange correlation functional and Hartree, because the equilibrium part is conveniently put inside this equilibrium term. So in practice, this equilibrium term is nothing but the band structure. So thus it contains the eigenvalues. You can start from DFT, so this is the band structure of silicon, for example. You can start from the LDA band structure, but it's a better starting point if you start from the quasi-particle energies. So in this case, the blue band structure. As you see in silicon, as in most semiconductors, the main effect is an opening of the gap and a stretching of the bands, which I'm not sure you can see here. Then the variation of the many body effects, which are contained here, there is the classical part and the exchange correlation part. They are both static. And one can start to compare to what is done instead in time-dependent density functional theory, which is, let's say, more known. So in density functional theory, time-dependent, the main difference is that here, instead of the self-energy, you have the exchange correlation potential of TD DFT, which in practice you also approximate with the adiabatic exchange correlation potential. And the main difference is that while the exchange correlation potential of TD DFT is local in space, the self-energy can be non-local in space. Indeed, the Fock term of the Hartree-Fock self-energy is strongly non-local, and of course even the screened version, the SEX, is strongly non-local. Okay, this is just the laser pulse. And of course, if you want to go beyond, to put dynamical effects, you can do that in principle, so this term will not be zero, but you have an expression to implicitly include them, while, for example, in TDDFT, there is not a systematic way to go beyond the adiabatic approximation. So, again, a few more comments on the equation. The first thing, we have this external field, which in YAMBO we express in this form. So it's what is called the length gauge, or the P dot E expression. So this is basically the polarization of the system, all this term, times the electric field. And as I said, since we choose a perturbation, we have an electric field which is polarized, we break some of the symmetry of the system. So this is represented here. So this is the Brillouin zone of bulk silicon. And in particular, there are highlighted here these L points, which are some of the special points of the Brillouin zone. They are 8 in total, and they are all related by symmetries. This means that when you do a DFT calculation, Quantum Espresso will just compute the wave functions in one of these L points. And to reconstruct the density, it will use the symmetries to get the wave functions at all the other L points. So in the save folder that you usually have for your YAMBO simulation, you will have the wave function just at this point, for example. Now you want to perform a simulation where there is an external field, which is represented here. And since there is an external field, the effect of the field on this point or on this point is different in general. So what you have to do, you have to take your wave function here and apply a rotation to also know the wave function here. This is the preliminary step of any real-time simulation. So after you do that, you have your density matrix at all the needed k points, and you can start the propagation. As I said, the equilibrium Hamiltonian contains the quasi-particle energies, so all the correlations from the ground state are here. And then the changes in the Hartree and exchange correlation potential gives the dynamical correlations. So these two terms, they evolve in time because they are functions of the density. The Hartree term gives the classical part of the electron-electron interaction, and it is somehow related, or it contains the same physics of what we called the local fields in linear response. And instead, the self-energy, which at the TDDFT level would have been simply the adiabatic exchange correlation potential, here we will approximate here with this variation of the SEX potential. It somehow contains the same physics of the electron interaction in the Bethe-Salpeter equation. And then I will show you in an example how this works in practice. And then we can also add an extra term. So here I squeezed the Hartree and the static part of the self-energy in a single term to make space to this extra term, which is a constant dephasing of this density matrix. So you can add id to, it's a phenomenological term, let's say, to have a diffusing term which is related to the smearing parameter you have used in linear response. It can be just a constant term, or you can even try to build it from first principle, and it's related to the quasi-particle lifetimes in this case. Okay, more comments on the classical field. So the Hartree field can be, in general, divided in two terms, the macroscopic one and the microscopic one. The macroscopic one is just the average of your simulation box of the change in the Hartree potential. And since it's the average over the supercell, you immediately see that It is zero for any system with dimensionality lower than 3. And the reason of that, so take this material, for example, boron nitride in two dimensions. So we do a simulation in the supercell, so indeed we have replicas, as we have seen in the other lectures. Ideally, the exact simulation would be with the distance in between the two layers, which goes to infinity. But if this distance goes to infinity, you have an integral, an average, over this infinite supercell with the layer just in a specific point, and this average gives zero. So there is no contribution to the macroscopic field in 2D, and the same arguments applies in 1D or in 0D. And instead, the microscopic part, it contains the local fields, and it's always there, both for reduced dimensionality or for 3D systems. So what changes when you go to 3D? So this is the bulk version of boron nitride. In this case, this macroscopic field is there. And the problem is that it is non-analytical in the density matrix, or in the density in general. R2 is indeed a functional of the density. And it is problematic to be described. It has something to do with the physics of longitudinal transverse splitting. I'm not going into the details. But I just want to mention that in practice, this term is not directly included in the R3 term, since it's non-analytical. So what one do is to take this away from the R3 term and put it back inside the external potential. And then the effect is that instead of having the external potential, one has here the total potential of the system. So the external one plus the induced polarization. So let's try to see what's the meaning of this density matrix to understand the physics which describes. One thing we can do, we can take the equation of motion and expand in first order, so this is the reason of the 1 year, with respect to the applied field. So if we apply to first order, this term just has the density matrix, so I put the first order density matrix. Here I have the equilibrium Hamiltonian, and again I put the first order density matrix. Here I have the change in the self-energy. So if I put the equilibrium density matrix, the change in the self-energy, it's zero if I evaluate it. So I have to evaluate the self-energy at the first order density matrix. And then in the commutator, I have to put the equilibrium density matrix here. Otherwise, I have a second order term. The field is by definition linear in itself, and so it commutes again with the equilibrium density matrix. So now that I did that, I can also expand linearly this variation. So I take just the functional derivative with respect to the density matrix times the change in the density matrix. So this expression is exact for functionals linear in Rho. And for example, the R3 plus X is linear in Rho, so it's an exact expression. And I can rewrite this one, you recognize, is by definition, the kernel of the Bethe-Salpeter equation. So I take this one, I plug it here, I get this equation. So the H equilibrium is just contains the quasi-particle energy, and since I have a commutator, it becomes the difference. And then this Rho equilibrium, it just contains the occupations, and again, since I have a commutator, I got the delta, the change in the occupations. And this is nothing but the Bethe-Salpeter equation. So it's a derivation from the density matrix to the Bethe-Salpeter equation, which is exactly the same of what Fulvio was showing yesterday. I underline again that this is not the full response function L, but is this L bar, because we have the response to the total potential and not to the external one. Now, one reason why this is instructive, because now, instead of staying in this space, I can apply the rotation to the excitonic space, to the wall equation. So the density matrix becomes a functional of the exciton index. And instead, all this term is the Bethe-Salpeter, which is diagonal in the excitonic space, and it just contains the excitonic energy. So it is replaced just by this term. So and here you easily see that if you integrate this equation, you just have a density matrix, which oscillates back and forth in time with a characteristic frequency, which is the excitonic frequency. So to first order, the effect of the a field applied to the system is just to create oscillations which are proportional to the excitonic energy. Or the excitonic energies, if I have the proper self-energy here. Or in any case, the energies which are captured by this Hamiltonian. Okay, so if I have something which oscillates back and forth in time, I can construct the polarization which will oscillate back and forth in time at this excitonic energy, or say at the energies described by this Hamiltonian, I can construct my absorption spectrum. So the first thing I can try, so this is what was shown in this paper 9 years ago. If I take the zero for the RT plus exchange correlation self-energy, then the equation is super simple. This density matrix will just oscillate at the quasi-particle energies which are here. So the polarization, and if I take the Fourier transform, which are it is the black line, it will be exactly as the independent particle or RPA response function. So you see that there is an exact correspondence between the Fourier transform approach, the black line, and the frequency space approach, which are the red circles. And if I instead put this H-sex Hamiltonian, I have a polarization which is oscillating at the excitonic energy, and the Fourier transform directly gives the excitonic spectrum. So this is again hexagonal boron nitride, which has a sharp exciton. The experimental data are in gray, and you see that the independent particle 1 was missing completely, this exciton, while instead the time-dependent sex simulation is capturing this effect. So it's really an equation of motion which gives a real-time approach to the beta-salpeter. Okay, a few more comments on this equation. I mean, it's the only equation we have to deal with, and I'm always representing it in the slides, and it is indeed the equation which is coded in Yambo RT. So for the external field, I have shown you before this expression, which is the length gauge, so it's the external field, E times the polarization. In principle, one could even use the A dot J, so the so-called velocity gauge. And I would say that both approaches have the advantages and the disadvantages. In Yambo, we mostly deal with the length gauge, although even the velocity gauge is implemented, at least for some cases. So one of the main disadvantages of the length gauge is that it needs depolarization. And the expression which is shown here for the polarization is valid only to first order. So it's valid only to first order in the density matrix. So I mean that if you apply the external field that you compute the first order density matrix in the external field, then you get the first order polarization and you can construct the linear response of the system. However, if you want to go beyond, you need something different, which is the theory of the Berry phase, which Claudio will describe later. On the other hand, if one uses the velocity gauge, this expression is in principle exact to all orders. The problem is that if one introduces a vector potential in this equation, then even the self-energy and the density matrix, but in particular the self-energy, needs to be gauged. And then another issue is that this equation of motion with a vector potential is numerically much less stable because there are some rules which numerically are almost never fulfilled and needs to be applied. So this is a reason why to use the velocity gauge is in practice very difficult, and you will see that to go beyond the linear regime, the Berry phase polarization has been chosen in the Yambo code. So another comment is that the theoretical equation is this one, but in practice we are dealing with a code, so we have to deal with finite differences. And the code, you cannot directly code the time derivative. So what you have a time propagation, so a time step propagation. So in practice, the equation of motion is this one. So if you want to know the density matrix at time t plus delta t, you take the density matrix at time t plus you add some term which depends on this Hamiltonian. So I stress this because there are, the real-time propagation is a technical point in the simulation, which is quite important. And there are different schemes which one can approach. So here I list three, which are coded in Yambo. The Euler scheme, which basically the simplest way you can think to propagate the density matrix, you just take this commutator and you use to time step the density matrix. The exponential scheme, which is a bit more accurate but even more demanding, where instead of directly applying the commutator, you use an exponential representation of this Hamiltonian operator. And then what we call the inversion scheme, which has this expression. This expression comes from the fact that in this is what I call an implicit scheme. Well, I'm not giving the details, but just to know. And it is even more complex than the exponential, but it is more accurate. I think that for linear response properties, in practice, we rely on this time stepping scheme, let's say, while for nonlinear optics, this time step scheme is mostly used, although for the wave functions. So this is how you propagate from step t plus to t plus dt with a single step, let's say, single step approach. You can do even better if you go to multi-step approaches, which are represented here. So the idea is that I want to go from t to times t plus dt, but instead of using just the information at time t, I would like to use the information at a time which is a bit later, at t plus dt and alpha. So this is a two-step scheme, because first then I have to propagate the density matrix with any of these schemes to time t plus dt and alpha, then construct this functional, and then propagate again. So you will see in the input file of the simulation that you will have a choice for the kind of single step scheme and a choice of the kind of multi-step approach. And regardless of which will be the scheme you choose, the time step dt needs to carefully be chosen, otherwise the simulation will diverge. Okay, and so with this I finish the first part on this, the idea of real-time spectroscopy, and I would like to stop a moment if you have questions on anything I've shown, and then in case I will have more time, I speak a bit about how to go beyond the static approximation to the self-energy. But first, if you have any question. Sorry, I said
that here the symmetry
does not work. So it's not that it doesn't work in general, let's say. So let me go back to this slide.
Yeah.
Okay, so here, for example, this is the case of silicon, and the silicon is symmetric with respect to, I think, 90 degree rotations, if I'm not wrong. And it means that all these 8 L points are equivalent. Now, if you apply an electric field along a specific direction, say 1, 1, 1, 1, then some of the rotations, for example, the rotations in plane, will leave the electric field unchanged, and these are consistent with this equation. You apply the symmetry, and even this term it remains the same under the application of the symmetry, and this symmetry is there. Instead, the rotation which send, let's say the field is on this direction, the electric field is not invariant anymore against this rotation. So in fact, there are still some symmetries, but less than the ones of the ground state. In the case of silicon in particular, there are in total 8 L points. And if you choose this field along the 1, 1, 1 direction, you end up with two groups of L points. The two ones which are in black are one group, and the other which are in blue are the other group. So you have some symmetry, but less than before.
If you compare with the equilibrium case,
yeah.
I don't know if there is any... Oh, okay. I don't know if we compare with the equilibrium case, is there any difference here?
I mean, there is not... not really any difference in the growth state of the system, if you want. Well, no, let me try to see. Suppose that you do a simulation with quantum espresso on bulk silicon, and you choose a grid, say 4 by 4 by 4. Yeah. So in total, there are 4 to the 3rd k points in the Brillouin zone, and then thanks to symmetry, I think the k points are reduced, let's say, to 10.
Yeah. Yes.
So you have 10 points in the IBZ, and so quantum espresso has to deal with just 10 k points for the wave functions.
Yeah. But here.
Now you apply the electric field and you remove some of the system, the symmetries, and you end up with maybe 20 k points.
Okay.
So you don't have all the k points, it's not 4 to the 3rd, but you have a bit more than what you have at the beginning.
Yeah.
And this is something you always have to remember before starting a simulation. So remove the symmetries and expand the wave functions. It is done by this YPP tool, so you don't really need to care in the ground state. Another question there.
Thanks. So my question is also about the external field. So can you play with maybe the strength of the field, for example, like the energy of the excitation too, and then see the population change as a function of time or something?
So when I say here, that you choose the perturbation, so here I've designed a couple of perturbations, but in practice, in the input, you will have a list of parameters which define the shape. So you could say delta, sine, field, then the intensity, which controls how strong is this field, then the polarization, which defines the direction of the field, and then, for example, some of the fields, not these two, but one of the most used indeed is a field which is the convolution of the sine with a Gaussian. So it defines the duration of, it's a pulse, and it has a duration. Then you can even define the duration of the pulse. It depends a lot on what you want to do, if you want to describe an experiment where they have a precise field, or if you want to do real-time spectroscopy. So for example, for real-time spectroscopy, this field is meant to be the probe. So if you want a probe, you want something which is broadband in frequency. And if you want something which is broadband, it is useful to have a delta function. On the other end, when you will see the lecture on nonlinear optics, if you want to see nonlinear optics, so you want to know the response of at a specific frequency, let's say omega, but then you want to know the response at 2 omega, which is the second order term, or 3 omega, then it is useful to have a perturbation at a defined frequency so that you can distinguish.
I had a question with the last section of the talk, where you had three cases with the commutator and the exponential and the inverse.
Okay, the time stepping. This one.
Yes. So, is there any specific specific calculation in which we are supposed to apply these, like commutator for this kind of calculation, expansion?
So
or
let's say that when you take the AMBO input file, there will be an input variable which where you have to define Eulero, exp, inverse, so you choose the kind of time propagation scheme. And well, for the beginning, you can leave it to the default. The default usually for YAMBRT it uses the Eulero time step combined with RK2, Runge-Kutta second order, and it will work fine. Then in real life, when you will start to do simulations, you can try to play, and you will see that these ones are the exponential or the inversion, for example. It is more stable, so it allows you to have a bigger time step, but it is also much more demanding. So it depends a bit on, the system, and you try and you see which is the best thing for you.
Okay, and I had another question with the pump probe. So you explained about the probe part, but what about the pump part?
So this first part of the lecture, it was just about real-time spectroscopy. It's just the probe. Then I have a few slides about the pump probe, just to give you a feeling, but it is not something you will see in the tutorial. So for now, we just start to play with real time, we put just one field and it's just a problem.
Thank you.
Okay.
Do I have to take additional care since we are going to transform with aliasing. Is this an issue here, or does this not appear?
Since we're going to Fourier transform?
Yeah, since we are going from real-time to omega, right?
Yep.
And there might be some issues with aliasing of the Fourier transformation.
What do you mean by aliasing?
High-frequency terms, low-frequency terms, something missing, something cutting off.
Okay.
Does
so
that happen here or not?
So I would say in generally no. And the reason is that, first of all, in this equation of motion, there is a natural cutoff, which is basically what you put here. So here you select the number of states you include. Let's say I take three conduction band and three valence band. And then the maximum energy difference which is included is the energy difference between the lowest band and the highest band, possibly renormalized by this term. And this is indeed one of the biggest advantages, I would say, of doing the propagation in this space compared to real space. So if you propagate in real space, like octopus code, then in principle you have any frequency, and then you need a smaller time step, and you have to care of these kind of things. And then the other reason is that, in any case, it is much more delicate to propagate the equation, so you need a small time step for the propagation. Then if the time step is enough for a stable propagation, is more than enough than for the Fourier transform. Indeed, what we do in practice, we propagate with a small time step, and sometimes we store even the polarization with a bigger time step, because we don't even need such an accurate time stepping.
You said that the time step has to be stable time step. So how do you determine that, whether the time step is stable or not stable?
If you propagate and the time step is too big, after a few iterations, you will see not a number in the simulation.
Okay.
And everything starts to diverge. It's really...
Thank you very much.
It's really straightforward. Okay, maybe I can go on with the second part. It's just, the second part is about ultra-fast physics, and it is just to give you a feeling of how all this could be, in principle, extended to the description of pump and probe experiments. You will not see that in the tutorial, but it is something we are working on. Hmm? It's not in the CBL, yeah. It's not, we are developing still it, we are... There are many issues in this part. It's much more involved and complex than the real-time analysis. But it's something that maybe in the future will be released in the GPL, and if you wait. And it's something which is, anyway, is in the YAMBO code. So when I speak about pump and probe experiment, I always start with this pictorial view of the human eye. And it shows you that the human eye is the instrument we mostly use to explore the space around us. And it is a very powerful instrument, but of course it has limitations, both on the spatial resolution and time resolution. And so the idea is that we can use exploit technology to overcome these limitations. So on the space side, the first to do that was Galileo, with the creation of the telescope, which allowed him in 1609 and 1610 to show to see for the first time the moons of Jupiter. And since then, the technology has grown a lot. And then from the telescope, we have been able to create the microscope and then other instruments more sophisticated. And now we are even able to see a picture of the atoms. So this is a picture which is now even 9 years old, a transmission electron microscopy image of graphene. You really see the atoms in graphene. On the time side, instead, the evolution took place much later. So I start with this portrait of a running horse, which was done in 1791. And here you see that there is a horse running, floating on the floor with the legs stretched. And indeed, this is not the way a horse runs. So this is not the way the legs moves when the horse is running. And the reason why it is wrong in this portrait is because the human eye is not able to resolve the legs of a horse, a running horse, at full speed. So the first time we were able to see the legs of a horse, it was the, in 1878, so almost 100 years later. And this is considered the first movie of the history. So it's a series of 16 pictures of a running horse. And you see that the situation which is the closest to the picture is maybe this one, to the portrait. But not all the legs of the horse are floating. So you see there is a difference in between the portrait. And this gives you an idea of how taking pictures, so basically using trains of light or laser pulses, can be used to overcome the limitations of the human eye. So this was the first result achieved more than 100 years ago. And even on the time side, the technology went on a lot. And there have been a couple of Nobel Prizes in this history. So the first Nobel Prize was given to these three guys in 1949 for their ability to study extremely fast chemical reaction. Extremely fast here means 10 to the minus 6 seconds, or 1 microsecond. And then, some years later, 1999, another Nobel Prize was awarded, again in chemistry, for the ability of studying chemical reaction, but this time with femtosecond time resolution. So from the microsecond up to the femtosecond, 10 to the minus 15 indeed. So it was a few hundred of femtoseconds in this case. And then you already see that if you take just the simple equation of motion for a classical atom, so you plug here the mass of an atom and here the typical strength on interaction between atoms, the time scale on which atoms move is around 100 femtoseconds. So with this technology, we can see the motion of the atoms. And then more recently, so this was now 20 years ago, people have been able to reach even the femtosecond time scale and even below, and so we are really able to see the motion of the electrons. So this is a representation of the kind of physics you can describe with ultra-short laser pulses, so arriving at this ultra-short time scale. So the first process is, of course, the absorption of the photons by the system and then the coherent dynamics. So what we have seen before, the fact that you send the pulse and the density matrix oscillates back and forth in time, is related to the absorption of photons and the coherent dynamics. And then there is a bunch of what I call dissipative process, which involves the electron-electron scattering, electron-photon scattering, and other processes, which are called dissipative process, and have something to do with the fact that the electrons in the material are interacting among themselves and with the photons, and so which requires dynamical self-energies, so the term which we have neglected before. And then, of course, there are longer time-scale processes which are also non-local in space, which cannot be described instead in an ab initio approach. So what I want just to quickly show you now is that we have up to now described this part of the equation, which describes the coherent evolution. But in YAMBO, and again, here is not yet available in the GPL distribution, we are also working on the description of this term, which takes into account all these processes. So a bit of theory about that. I told you there are these two coupled equations for the Green function, with the collision integral, which depends explicitly on the self-energy and on the two-time Green function. And this set of equations are called Kadanoff-Bame equations, are exact if one could put the exact expression, but in practice one cannot use the exact equations because they are too much demanding. But anyway, one can do controlled approximations to the Kadanoff-Bame equations. And the other remark is that they are computationally very demanding. And one of the reasons is that this is a function of two times, so you don't have to propagate on the time diagonal, as we did up to now, but you have to propagate both on t and t prime axis. So the time propagation grows a lot the cost grows a lot, because the more you go up in time, the more points you have to consider. And moreover, this collision integrals depends on the history of the quantity you propagate. So there is memory. So it is a scheme with scales like T cube. So before we saw that neglecting this term, we can write an equation for the density matrix. But if you include this term, such equation is not closed anymore because I test this time integral. And what one can do to close this equation is to introduce this GKBA, generalized Kalanov-Bey-Mansatz. Okay, I don't want to go in the details, just to give you a feeling is that you represent this two-time function via an expression where you put just the density matrix, the time diagonal. So you close the equation if you know the expression of this propagator, which you can express in some way. So in this case, you obtain an equation which is closed for the density matrix, and is just an equation for rho. And compared to the full Kalanov-Bey equation, this equation still scales with t squared because you still have the memory in the collision integral. And if you want an equation which scales linearly in time, you have to neglect the memory. And this is what we do in the YAMBO code. So we use this approximation, GKBA, we neglect memory, we use a specific expression, which is the ab initio expression for the propagator, which enters here in the collision integral. And then this equation, let's now forget for a moment about the static correlation we've seen so far. Now they have this collision integral, which we further simplify as a function of the time diagonal only. And this is an equation for the occupations of the electrons on the material. So, and in particular, this term contains all the scattering processes. So for example, if you take the electron phonon self-energy, it will describe the evolution of electrons due to electron phonon. And the equation as before can be expanded in the applied field, and it becomes an equation which to first order describes the polarization, what we have seen before, and to second order really describes the evolution of the occupations. So this is the physics capture. So you apply the field, you induce these oscillations, then the field enters again, it couples with the oscillations, so you see this term, this time, and it creates really electrons in the conduction and those in the valence. And then the collision integrals, which takes this form, it has a form of a semi-classical Boltzmann equation describes the time evolution. Okay, this is just to give an overview of the things which are going on in the code and a simple example of an application, a pump and probe experiment, where we have this time two laser pulses. The first is the pump, which is resonant to the optical gap of silicon and excites electrons from the valence to the conduction band. And the second is a probe which photoemits from the conduction band. And this is the intensity of the photoemission signal. So it goes up in time with the pump pulse, and then it goes down because electrons, so the photoemission indeed is monitored from this valley, and it goes down in time because the electrons from here, they scatter down here. And again, there is the electric field, so this is the picture you have seen. So you break some of the symmetries of the material, and here you see more in detail the effect. So the electrons are injected in this L point, so this one, but not in the L prime point. So you see that there are electrons injected here, but much less here. And then they evolve due to electron phonon scattering, so they scatter from here to here, and then to the minimum of the conduction bed. Okay, so this is just to give you a feeling of how the approach could be in principle extended to capture the physics of pump and probe experiments. And I think I will stop here. So I don't know if you have...